this the paper will be focused on the public interest environmental litigation in Sri Lanka, hitting the net after reaching the Senate. And this is focused on the human rights aspects, basically regarding the environmental rights. This would be the outline of the presentation. To begin with, the environmental litigation, the first and foremost, the concept of logo standi should be clarified. And the concept of the logo standi was developed by the English court throughout many ages, and it has become significant part of the administrative law as well. Simply, the defining the logo standi, the right of a party to demonstrate a court sufficient connection to the harm, cause or the action challenge to support the party that the participation in case. Right. Coming to public interest litigation, it has been developed through the judicial activism, basically of the Indian Supreme Court. And it is this has been developed throughout to the ensure the security of the human rights. Now the main features of PIL, basically we can find three features. The action must be commenced not for the commencement of the individual grievance of the petitioner, but for the grievance of a group that compromise the public of that group. The petitioner may be one such person with a grievance, or he may be a public spirited person through his taking the matter on behalf of the others. And also PLI is to vindicate the rule of law and to facilitate the access to justice to those who are economically weak. These are the basic underlying principle of the public interest litigation which we are focused on, relating to the environmental litigation practices, the sustainable development, intergenerational equity, polluter pays, precautionary actions, common but differentiated principles, and the public trust and public guardianship. When it comes to Sri Lankan position relating to public interest litigation, environmental litigation, basically we have three main case studies: the Goldfields leasing case, the Paolo Phosphate case, and the Kandalama case. And it seems to be that the Sri Lankan court had adopted and encouraged PIL in the early stages in the environmental protection sector. And these are the basic legal firms who are engaged in the securing the rights of the environmental issues relating to Sri Lankan citizens. Environmental Foundation Limited, Colombo 5, Green Movement of Sri Lanka, Nugegoda, Center for Environmental Justice, Colombo 8, and the Public Interest Law Foundation, Colombo 7. In this research, we have two objectives. Research is to evaluate the gradual development of public interest environmental litigation in Sri Lankan context. The duration is past 2 decades. And to analyze the contribution made by PLI for the advancement of right to information, comparing with jurisdiction or foreign jurisdiction. These are some of the literature review in a sort of public interest litigation sector. The famous case, S.P. Gupta versus Union versus India. And here, the restructure the view relating to standing. And then Justice Dahl attitude toward the public interest litigation in the People's Union of Democratic Rights and Minister of Home Affairs, Delhi Royal Court. The attitude of the courts ought to be one of the trust and not one of the confirmation. The condition that must be fulfilled before the PIL is entertained by the Superior Court is that the court should be in the position to give effective, complete relief. If no effective and complete relief can be granted, the court should not entertain PIL. That leads certain limitation to the PIL context. And then coming into an English case, Shaw versus DPP, the Lord Simmons. This is the Sri Lankan context, the Bulankulam versus Minister of Industrial Development. In shortly, we know this case as a Paola Paspate case, the famous judgment delivered by Dr. A.R.B. Amarasinghe, Justice A.R.B. Amarasinghe. The organs of the state are guardians to whom the people have committed the care and preservation of the resources of the people. This accords not only with the scheme of the government set out in the Constitution, but also with the high enlightened and concepts of the duties of our rulers in the efficient management resources in the process of development. And further, he emphasized the sustainable development principles and principles related to the state responsibility of state guardianship, etc. The methodology of this research would be in two type of and qualitative and the quantitative approach. And here we are going to discuss these kind of data discussion. Public interest litigation in relation to environmental sectors are being discouraged due to following factors. The basic one is public apathy, because the problem with the unknown about their rights and how the extent of their rights and what is the scope of the right, and there is no any mechanism to be educated them and figure out what they are supposed to do if a certain matter being a right relating to the environmental aspects. And then the difficulty to obtain the information on the relevant matters due to certain factors, illiteracy and ignorance, and some people, they do not know where they have to go in such kind of matters, and likewise. And then inability to comprehend the technical information gathered. And this, now the environmental litigation practice in Sri Lanka was, at the initial phase, it was in high standard and judicial activism was very high, and it maintained a very good standard at that point, with lot of interpretation or judicial interpretation came up with, and different very effective and nourished judgment were came out. But in present context, we do not find any such kind of nourished judgment delivered by the judicial people, and it is something to be honestly said, that lack of creativity of the judiciary. And the language barrier, most of the things relating to this public environmental litigation is being published in the language of English. And since the Sri Lanka via the language policy is being implemented, and the Sinhala language acts are going to be in the first place, and if they are not available in Sinhala language, there are a certain barrier to have the information related to these kind of things and where their rights have been violated and what are the precautions that they could do if a certain right has been violated, and would that be the maximum maximum protection that they could achieve when there are certain violation being occurred. And then the last factor that we identified for the reason for the decline of the judicial activism, less creativity of the judiciary, that might be due to the maybe some kind of political reasons, or might be the workload of the judiciary and the stagnating of the principles relating to like the people are not coming on the violation of fundamental rights relating to human rights, relating to the environmental matters, and courts have no such cases coming through before the courts likewise. However, most of the factors are going to be affected due to this last point, the less creativity of the judiciary. Then we had a certain limitation when we are talking about this topic, and the focus group discussions and interviewed held only the PILA activists, legal professionals, academic judges in the Colombo jurisdiction. The reason was the PIL jurisdiction remains largely in the Supreme Court of Sri Lanka, with mostly the PIL cases comes as a form of fundamental rights, and the fundamental rights jurisdiction lies with the Supreme Court, so that our study was restricted into the Colombo area. And these are our references. Thank you.